In this next video, we'll talk about why it is we eat in the first place, and also some common nutritional disorders. So why is it that we eat in the first place? Well, proper nutrition helps us to maintain homeostasis. A balanced diet provides for us fuel energy for cellular work and also building materials. To construct our own macromolecules that we need to make our body. So let's talk about food in both of these aspects. First, as fuel. Cells break down food molecules during cellular respiration. In this process, they generate many molecules of ATP. This event happens within the mitochondria of eukaryotic cells. Again, it requires oxygen and food molecules as the reactants, and the products will be carbon dioxide and water. So how much energy is stored in the food that we eat? Well, we use a specific unit of measure known as the calorie to discuss this. Calories measure the amount of energy stored in the food that we eat. However, we can also use calories as a measure of the energy we expend in daily activities. We can see a relationship here. The calories we get from consuming food and the calories we spend doing work should be in somewhat of a balance if our goal is to maintain a constant body weight. If there's an imbalance, we will either lose or gain weight based on the direction of the imbalance. The metabolic rate of an organism is the rate of energy consumption per day. A definition of a calorie is the amount of energy required to raise the temperature of a gram of water by 1 degree centigrade. This is the definition of calorie that will be used in physics and will be used in chemistry. A kilocalorie is 1,000 calories with a little c, yet this is the unit listed on food labels. Sometimes it's just called calorie with a capital C, which is a bit unfortunate. So here we see a chart which compares the amount of energy received from certain food items and the amount of energy spent with certain activities. And using this chart, we can figure out the length of time we can do the following activities based on the food item that was consumed. So assuming we ate a slice of pepperoni pizza and received 280 kcals for that, well, that's equivalent to about 42 minutes worth of swimming or 22 minutes worth of jogging. A cheeseburger at 417 kcals is equivalent to 1 hour and 42 minutes worth of walking. That's the amount of energy that would be spent just doing that activity for that length of time. Now, you're not expected to memorize this chart, but I do want you to see and realize a relationship between the energy received from consuming food and the energy spent by performing activities. Next, we can talk about food as a building material. The cells of our body assemble polymers from the monomers that we get by digesting our food. This process of building up polymers from monomers is an endergonic reaction. So some of the energy that we get from digesting our food can go right back into building up macromolecules within our body. Now, essential nutrients are substances, building blocks, that are needed by the body, but that the body cannot make itself. This means we need to get our essential nutrients from the food that we eat. Out of the 20 amino acids, there are 8 which are considered to be essential for humans. Now, different foods contain different essential nutrients. If an individual is a vegetarian or vegan, and so they're relying solely on plant materials in order to get their protein, they can still get all 8 essential amino acids, but they need to do this by eating a variety of plant proteins. They need to eat plant proteins both from legumes and from grains. If they just are relying on one or another, they might become deficient in some of these essential amino acids. Now, it's even as simple as having beans and rice together in a meal that will allow you to get those essential amino acids from plant materials. The next essential nutrients that I'd like to talk about are vitamins and minerals. Even though these two substances are often listed together, they are technically different. With vitamins being organic molecules that are essential in the diet for good health, many of these vitamins are going to function as assistants to enzymes. And minerals, which are inorganic substances required in the diet, these will often be elemental nutrients such as calcium or iron. There are also essential fatty acids. Our cells make fats and other lipids by combining fatty acids with other molecules. Essential fatty acids are those fatty acids that we cannot make from simpler molecules. You may even have heard of these in the form of omega-3 fatty acids. In the United States of America, there's a division of the federal government known as the FDA, or the Food and Drug Administration. And this division places rules that are put on food items that are sold. They require that food items have food labels. And these food labels include a list of ingredients, and key nutritional facts. Included on these food labels, you'll often see percentages. These are known as RDAs, or recommended daily allowances. Now, these RDAs are minimum standards established by nutritionists for preventing nutrient deficiencies. Here we see an example of a food label that not only lists the calories present in a serving of this food item, but also a breakdown of some of the different macromolecules like protein and carbohydrate and fat content, and then also a variety of vitamins and minerals which are present, and what percentage of the daily recommended value is represented by a serving of this particular food item. We're going to finish up this discussion of the digestive system by talking about what happens if we have a nutritional disorder. Now, nutritional disorders can lead to a variety of severe problems. Two examples of these would be malnutrition and undernutrition. Malnutrition is specifically a dietary deficiency of one or more of the essential nutrients. You can think of this as a lack of building materials. An example of malnourishment would be scurvy. Scurvy is a condition in which an individual has an inadequate supply of vitamin C, and it can cause a variety of different symptoms, including poor wound healing, skin coloration changes, and also the loss of teeth. Undernutrition is caused by an inadequate intake of calories. We can think of this as a lack of fuel. This would be a case where an individual is receiving a severely limited diet. They're on starvation conditions. They just aren't able to get enough calories to power the activities of their body. Now, in most modern developed countries, it would be far easier to be malnourished without being undernourished Because this can happen just by eating junk food or fast food or just not having a balanced diet. However, if an individual is undernourished, they're likely also going to be malnourished as well. If they aren't able to get enough food in general, likely they are not receiving a balanced diet. Now, another aspect of nutritional dysfunction is obesity. Obesity is an inappropriately high ratio of weight to height. In this picture, we see two different lab mice. Now, the lab mouse with the orange spot on his cheek, it has a particular mutation in the receptor for the hormone ghrelin. This hormone causes feelings of hunger, and with the mutated receptor, it's always active, continually telling this mouse that it's hungry. So if it is left with food, it will continue to eat that food. Now, not all human cases of obesity are linked to this particular hormone or hormone malfunction, but it is possible that some tendency towards obesity can be inherited. Not only due to genetics, but also from acquired familial behavior and interactions with food. With that, that takes us to the end of our discussion of the digestive system. The next organ system which we'll discuss is the circulatory system. See you in the next video.